The Five Barbarians, or Wu Hu, is a Chinese historical exonym for ancient non-Han Chinese peoples who immigrated to northern China in the Eastern Han Dynasty, and then overthrew the Western Jin Dynasty and established their own kingdoms in the 4th-5th centuries. The peoples categorized as the Five Barbarians are the Xiongnu, Ji, Xiabe, Dai, and Qiang. Of these five ethnic groups, the Xiongnu and Xiabe were nomadic peoples from the northern steppes. The ethnic identity of the Xiongnu is uncertain, but the Xiabe appear to have been Mongolic. The Ji, another pastoral people, may have been a branch of the Xiongnu who may have been Yeniseian or Indo-Scythian. The Dai and Qiang were from the highlands of western China. The Qiang were predominantly herdsmen and spoke Sino-Tibetan languages, while the Dai were farmers who may have spoken a Sino-Tibetan language. Definition: the term Five Hu was first used in the Spring and Autumn Annals of the 16 Kingdoms, which recorded the history of the late Western Jin Dynasty and the 16 kingdoms, during which rebellions and warfare by and among non-Han Chinese ethnic minorities ravaged northern China. The term Hu in earlier texts had been used to describe the Xiongnu, but became a collective term for ethnic minorities who had settled in North China and took up arms during uprising of the Five Barbarians. This term included the Xiongnu, Xiabe, Dai, Qiang, and Ji. Later historians determined that more than five nomadic tribes took part, and the Five Barbarians has become a collective term for all nomadic people residing in northern parts of the past empires of China. The Southern Xiongnu. The Xiongnu were a people who had migrated in and out of China proper, especially during times of turmoil, apparently at least since the days of the Qin dynasty. The Chanihu Hanya signed a Heian agreement with Han China in 53 BCE. In 48 CE, after a dynastic conflict within the Xiongnu Confederacy, an unnamed Shani brought 8 tribes of the western wing to China under a renewed Heian treaty, creating a polity of southern Xiongnu in vassalage to China and a polity of northern Xiongnu who maintained their independence. As the northern Xiongnu declined under internal and external conflicts, the southern Xiongnu received waves of new migrants, and by the end of the 1st century CE a majority of the Xiongnu resided in China proper and along its northern borders. In the 190s CE the southern Xiongnu revolted against attempts of the Chinese court to appoint a puppet southern Shani against their will. Dong Jian, who was boastful of his victories, forsook the rules which could keep peace, and was unfair and greedy, seized the right to frighten and pardon, again installed Shani for northern Hu, returned him to the old court, began favoring both Shanyus, and thus, for his own prosperity, violated the principles of justice and have sown seeds of great evil. The southern Xiongnu then elected a Shani from the Suabu in 188 CE and Chizu Shi Juhou Chani fled back to the Chinese court. After the death of the new Shani in 196 CE, most of the southern Xiongnu left to join the northern Xiongnu and only 5 tribes remained in China. The War of the Eight Princes during the Jin Dynasty triggered a large-scale southern Xiongnu uprising after 304, which resulted in the sacking of the Chinese capitals at Luoyang and Chang'e. The Xiongnu Kingdom of Hanzhou captured and executed the last 2 Jin emperors as the Western Jin Dynasty collapsed in 317. Many Chinese fled south of the Yangtze as numerous tribesmen of the Xiongnu and remnants of the Jin wreaked havoc in the north. Fu Jian temporarily unified the north, but his achievement was destroyed after the Battle of Fei River. The Northern Wei unified North China again in 439 and ushered in the period of the Northern Dynasties. The Five Barbarians after the fall of Northern Xiongnu. In the 1st century the Eastern Han Dynasty brought the Northern Xiongnu into submission by military measures. Hordes of herdsmen and the southern Xiongnu, originally subdued by the northern Xiongnu, began trading without having heavy tribute imposed on them. In return, those herdsmen helped defend the Han dynasty against any remaining Xiongnu. The more they engaged in commerce with the Chinese, the more they preferred to stay near China's border to facilitate trade, instead of residing on the steppes of Manchuria and Mongolia. Some groups of non-Xiongnu herdsmen even settled permanently within the Chinese borders, first of which was the Wuhuan, who migrated to the area of today's province of Liaoning during the era of Zhang Wu. Note that the southern Xiongnu migrated before the Wuhuan but not for commercial reasons. Liaison among the dynasty and groups of herdsmen relied on mutual economic and military benefits. As the northern Xiongnu, the masters of the Mongolian steppes and mortal enemy of the Han dynasty, were still potent enough during the reigns of Emperor Ming, Emperor Zhang and Emperor He to keep the volatile alliance intact. The Eastern Han dynasty enjoyed the most prosperous years of its almost 200 years of existence. Even fragments of the northern Xiongnu migrated well within the border to the Xihe Plain, west of the Huanghe and south of the Ordos Desert. The picture drastically changed in the later years of reign of Emperor He, son of Emperor Zhang, Dao Jian, brother-in-law of Emperor Zhang through his sister Empress Duo, utterly defeated the northern Xiongnu in a series of campaigns during the Yongyuan era. The remnants just escaped annihilation, conceded defeat, began migrating out of the Mongolian steppes and disappeared as a distinct group of herdsmen once and for all. Others were assimilated into other tribes by intermarriage, the Yuan tribe being a good example. In their wake, a power vacuum was left on the Mongolian steppes. The main contenders were the southern Xiongnu, who inhabited a region to the south of the steppe and had now grown into a group of more than 100,000 herdsmen on the Xihe Plain, the Xiabi, who lived in the east of the steppe residing on the plains of Manchuria, the Dingaling, who originally dwelt on the banks of Lake Baikal and had already commenced trekking south into the steppes before Duo Jian destroyed the northern Xiongnu, and the Wuhuan, who lived south of the Xiabe and were the weakest of the four. Instead of constantly trading for provisions, tools and luxuries, these four powerful groups of herdsmen, though still allies of the Han dynasty, often cooperated to plunder areas of the northern border. The dynasty could not muster an all-out campaign to wipe them out, but often attempted, through diplomatic and monetary measures, to split one or more groups from the alliance of herdsmen. On the other hand, the dynasty was constantly declining as clans of consorts and eunuchs engaged in a continuous struggle for power. Wealthy merchants and aristocrats were acquiring lands from peasants who had been cultivating their own land for years. Landless peasants had to come under the protection of the rich and so pay rent to these new landowners rather than pay taxes to the government. Coupled with bureaucratic corruption, tax revenues dropped dramatically. Large landholding families also took advantages of the weakness of central government and established their own armies. Increasingly, governors of regions administered their territories as independent rulers. The recruitment of troops and tax collection could be carried out at the discretion of the regional governors, contributing to the disunity that led to the inevitable crumbling of China into the Three Kingdoms. The dynasty also had to deal with the Qiang and Dai on the western border, who had constantly been involved in skirmishes against the dynasty since the middle of Western Han dynasty. As the Eastern Han dynasty declined, the Qiang, nominal ancestors of modern Tibetans, began planning major invasions through spies and collaborators. The Han court knew about the situation and had to deploy soldiers near the border to fend off Qiang skirmishes and small-scale invasions. Although few major Qiang invasions were carried out, never successfully, such a military deployment constantly drained the treasury and was a cradle for ambitious militarists, the most famous of whom was Dong Duo, the pretender to the Han court from 189 to 192. The more the Han court weakened through domestic problems, the more the herdsmen craved the dynasty's wealth. The Wu Huan were a frequent ally with the Han court against Zha Bei and the southern Zhong Yu, although they also sometimes allied with the Zhong Yu to fend off joint attacks by the Han and Zha Bei. The Han court also deployed mercenaries from the Zha Bei and Wu Huan for campaigns against the rebels and to quell peasant insurgents. These mercenaries were often sympathetic to the peasant uprising and hence not trusted by the Han military authorities. However, they were the best available option for suppressing the insurgents, and consequently these soldiers were poorly treated by being deployed far away from their homeland, or in the most dangerous positions on the battlefield, or by starving them of provisions and weapons. Thus, military who could earn the trust of the Zha Bei or Wu Huan would collaborate with the tribes for the sake of their own careers. For instance, a unit of about 5,000 Wu Huan cavalry that usually resided in Yu province was deployed in southern Jing province for 3 consecutive years. The rebellions of Zhang Chan and Zhang Ju in Yu province in alliance with this Wu Huan cavalry unit marked the first of many such collaborations. Yuan Shao and Gong Sun Zan, two warlords of the end of Han dynasty, also exploited Wu Huan and Zha Bei respectively in their own quests for predominance. Ironically, Gong Sun Zan was the commander tasked with suppressing the rebellion of Zhang Chun and Zhang Ju, Zha Bei Confederacy of Tanshuai. The difficult relationship between the Han court and various nomadic groups lasted from the start of the 2nd century to the early 160s and the appearance of Tanshuai, an illegitimate son of a low-ranking military officer of Zha Bei mercenaries deployed against the southern Zhong Yu. Despite his low social status among Zha Bei herdsmen, he managed to unify all the Zha Bei tribes under his rule in a confederacy against the Han court. Each Zha Bei tribe was led by a chieftain and were grouped under the confederacy into 3 smaller federations, the Western, the Central and the Eastern. Notable chieftains under Tanshuai were Murong, Huata and Tuyin. The confederacy was a rudimentary centralized government. All tribes had to share all trade profits, military duties and a unified stance against the Han court. Slavery was also important, as captives were forced to work to provide provisions and weapons. Supported by this confederacy, Tanshuai brought the southern Zhong Yu into a close alliance. The Wu Huan, Dingaling, Qiang and Dou were at times aiding the confederacy, which now included all the major tribes on the steppes stretching from today Jilin province to central Xinjiang. Uneasiness at the Han court about this development of a new power on the steppes finally ushered in a campaign on the northern border to annihilate the confederacy once and for all. In 177 AD, 30,000 Han cavalry attacked the confederacy, commanded by Chia Yu, Tianyan and Zhang Min, each of whom was the commander of units sent respectively against the Wu Huan, the Qiang, and the southern Zhong Yu before the campaign. Each military officer commanded 10,000 cavalrymen and advanced north on 3 different routes, aiming at each of the 3 federations. Cavalry units commanded by chieftains of each of the 3 federations almost annihilated the invading forces. 80% of the troops were killed, and the 3 officers, who only brought tens of men safely back, were relieved from their posts. Tanshuai found a temporary solution when he sacked the area of modern Jilin province. To make the matters worse, the successes of Tanshuai after his death in 181 never earned the respect from the chieftains of the 3 federations. They were also less ambitious and constantly fought among themselves for the increasingly powerless lord of confederacy. On the other hand, tribes began to emigrate from the steppe, mainly to the southwest and southeast for better pasture. The weakness of the Han court also encouraged tribes to move further into China. For example, the Chufa tribe, an offshoot of the Tuyin, settled in the eastern mountainous area of today Qinghai province. Thus, the effective border of dynasty was pushed further south and east. The confederacy was virtually dissolved in early 3rd century, therefore the warlords of the Han dynasty could play their own game of fighting for supremacy without much interference from tribes outside China. Barbarian immigration during the Three Kingdoms. As the Eastern Han dynasty slowly disintegrated into an era of warlords, battles for predominance eventually ushered in the Three Kingdoms. However, years of war had generated a severe shortage of labor, a solution to which was the immigration of foreigners. Thus the Wei court, controlling northern China at the time, allowed weaker tribes to settle in areas depopulated by war. Several large-scale forced relocations of Dai to southwestern Shaanxi and northern Sichuan took place in the 220s. Surprising to some historians, the immigration went smoothly since no powerful confederacy of any tribes was established. The Wu Huan, partisans of Yuan Shao and his sons, had already been squashed when Cao Cao sent an expedition into Yu province. Its herdsmen were dispersed all over northern China and were no longer a major threat. The later years saw only border skirmishes as the three governments concentrated on reclaiming the loss of productivity. Thus, after the unification under the Western Jin dynasty, an era of prosperity began as the relocated tribes adopted agriculture and contributed to the revival of the economy. Other tribes, still residing in the areas that they had occupied since the Eastern Han dynasty, frequently served as mercenaries against minor rebellious chieftains such as Kebaneng and Tufishu Jineng. However, the Jin bureaucracy forgot an underlying threat. Living in areas well south of the Great Wall and closer than ever before to the capital of China at Luoyang, any widespread uprising by the Wu Hu would be impossible to halt. Jin dynasty and the uprising of the Five Barbarians. An era of relative prosperity had existed since Jin would have unified China in 280. The so-called barbarians residing inside and near China regularly paid taxes to the Jin court. They traded horses and animal products for agricultural goods and silk and could be paid to fight as mercenaries. Some officials foresaw a crisis. Discussion of the god of money and discussion on tribe relocation condemned the decadence of the aristocracy and warned of an uprising by ethnic minorities living in northern China. The latter work provides accurate locations of the region where the ethnic minorities resided. Southern Xiongnu now dominated Bingzhou and their horsemen could arrive at Jinyang in half a day's ride and Luoyang, the capital, in a few days. The accession of the Jin Emperor Hui in 290 marks the beginning of the crumbling of the Jin dynasty. Possibly retarded at birth, he was a puppet of powerful parties which sought to control the Jin court. During the rebellion of the Eight Kings, all parties in power attempted to wipe out the former rulers by murder, mass executions or battles. Each struggle grew more violent and bloodier than the one before. Not surprisingly, Wu Hu mercenaries were often called upon. Wu Hu chieftains and herdsmen clearly comprehended the selfishness of the nobility and the destruction of the country through their struggle for power and wealth. Coupled with famine, epidemic and floods, cannibalism was observed in some parts of the country only a few years after Emperor Hui's accession. Wu Hu herdsmen saw no reason to obey orders from the Jin court and widespread uprisings soon followed. The revolt by Qi Wanyan, a Dai chieftain residing in the border region of today's Shaanxi and Sichuan provinces, marked the first such uprising. His group of insurgents, which was mainly made up of Dai and Qiang tribesmen, numbered around 50,000. Although his revolt was suppressed after 6 years of destructive battles, waves of refugees and remnants wreaked havoc in neighboring territories. The first of the 16 kingdoms was founded by a group of Dai refugees who fled into Sichuan.